Hello, everyone. My name is Mandy Curtis, and I'm a writer for the website For Every Young Adult, a site for people who are a little less Y and a bit more A. Thanks for joining us today during the 2021 North Texas Teen Book Festival for this Hello Darkness, My Old Friend panel featuring authors Shaun David Hutchinson, Amie Kaufman, Jay Kristoff, and Marie Liu. But before we start the conversation, I need to do a little bit of housekeeping. The North Texas Teen Book Festival is usually held in person in Irving, Texas, but this year's event is virtual, obviously, which makes it possible to reach readers and book lovers across the world in a safe manner. Super exciting that we get to do this virtually this year. Thanks to all of you for watching, and definitely think about coming to Irving when the festival is again held in person. I can tell you from experience that it's a fantastic event. If you'd like to talk about this or any of the other panels that you've seen today or watched yesterday, please check out hashtag NTTBF21 on all social media platforms. Keep the conversation going. Now, without further ado, I'll ask our panel to introduce themselves and tell us a little bit about the books that we're here to talk about today. Let's start with Jay, because you are right here in the Zoom.
Terrible. I usually avoid the leftmost seat because you always get called on first. Hello, everybody. I am Jay Kristoff. My partner in crime, Amie Kaufman, is, well, you're below me on my screen. I don't know where you are on everybody else's, but we are co-authors of The Aurora Cycle. We are going to be talking, the latest book we brought out together was Aurora Burning, and the third part of that series, which we can't spoil the title of, and I will try my best not to say today during the panel, is coming out at the end of this year.
Awesome. Amie, let's kick it over to you.
Hi, I'm Amie Kaufman, and diagonal to Jay, I could have sworn. Yeah, so I'm Jay's partner in crime. We have the Illuminae Files and the Aurora Cycle together. I've also, because I like stuff in space, I guess. I have a bunch of other stuff. I have the Starbound trilogy with Megan Spooner, and my latest, The Other Side of the Sky, which is not quite in space, but we'll say suborbital, that series.
Awesome. All right, Shaun, how about you?
Oh, sure. Hi, I am Shaun David Hutchinson, and I'm actually here with my latest book. It came out January 19th. It's called A Complicated Love Story Set in Space, and I've been calling it Gays in Space for like the last 2 or 3 years, which is how I kind of pitched it. And it's just about three characters, Noah, DJ, and Jenny, who wake up on a spaceship, and it's complicated.
The cover is amazing.
It is. Thank you. I died when I saw that cover. Like, they did such an amazing job with it.
Yeah.
I died when I saw the title. I was like,
yeah.
What's it about? Like, perfect.
Well, like, it was really cool how it came out, because like we couldn't figure out what to call it, and I was like, I really wanted Gays in Space. I was like, please, like just let me keep that. And they were like, no. And so my agent was, we were writing back and forth to my editor, and she was like, it's just like this really complicated love story set in space. And we were like, let's just do that. Damn. Like, keep it. Let's go with it.
Yep.
Awesome. And last but not least, Marie.
Hi, everyone. I am Marie Liu, and my latest is Sky Hunter, which is a new science fiction duology that just came out last fall, and the next one is coming out this fall. It is, I'm trying to figure out I've been writing this series for years, and I still haven't figured out how to summarize it briefly, but it's basically monsters versus monster hunters is about as close as I can get.
Nice. Well, thank y'all for being here with us today. And so I'm going to kick things off with some questions, and then we're going to move on to some audience submitted questions as well. First of all, and I promised the crew at the festival that I would ask you guys this, how dare you, all of you? Just going to leave that there.
We get that a lot.
But I'm sure you do.
I mean, it's kind of tricky though, right? Because like, I don't know about you guys. I feel like it's definitely going to be a yes. Like, you wake up every morning to all caps on social media, like every morning without exception, someone is yelling at you, how dare you? And it's like, it feels like you want me to apologize. I was trying to do this to you, and you knew I was. So.
And you came back for more.
It's not like this is
a surprise.
Yeah. Right. Like, at some point, this is on you, really, is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
It's true. It's true. We're all, readers are inherently gluttons for punishment, I think, in a little bit of a way. But anyway, yes, thank you for answering that. It was a bit of a joke, but I appreciate that you guys go with that.
We do it out of love.
Yes, yes.
We do it because you like it. Well, let's be honest.
I mean, there's a little revenge in there as well. I don't know. Maybe right. That's just me.
Because right, we're readers as well. Like, we've had our turn right. Screaming, how dare mm-hmm. you?
Oh, mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. True. You're just like, uh-huh, let me just...
Passing it down. Next generation.
So as the panel description implies, all of the books we're here to talk about today are science fiction novels that feature a touch of darkness. So here's a two-part question for y'all. Why write science fiction? And what about the genre lends itself to stories about the dark side?
Oh, I feel like the answers to those two questions are actually intertwined, because, you know, there are so many reasons to write sci-fi. I still remember one time sitting in a podcast and they were asking me about, you know, why do you write space opera? And I can hear myself giving this very fancy answer, you know, about epic scope. But in my head, it's like a tiny part of me being like, because it's so cool.
Knowing that I can't say that.
But you know, there's this fantastic scope in sci-fi to kind of explore who we are right now and what the consequences of that might be. You know, we're looking at how the actions of today will translate into the future, and kind of in a way giving ourselves a chance to rehearse lots of different futures. And, you know, that doesn't mean that literally Marie's like, if we don't make good choices now, there'll be monsters. It's more about, you know, we're talking about like our moral choices and, you know, our choices as a society. And I think you can't help but go some dark places when you start asking those sort of questions.
Yeah. The best, my favorite kind of science fiction was always the kind that studied the problems of today through the lens of futurism. You're kind of putting degrees of separation, you know, be it sci-fi trappings, alien races, interstellar distances, but you're still ultimately studying the problems that we as a society and a species are facing now. So you can look at potential consequences for our current actions, or you can provide potential solutions for the current problems that we face. So it doesn't always have to go to dark places, but, you know, great storytelling is about creating problems for your characters, creating crises that they have to overcome. And if you're looking at this world now through the lens of futurism, you know, we do have some pretty real problems that we're facing as a species right now. So even though it might go to dark places, I think ultimately a lot of it is quite hopeful in tone, weirdly enough for us.
Yeah, that's a really good point that Jay hit on, because I think all of our stories are very dark, but they all have that thread of optimism in them. And for me, I always feel this sense of control when I'm writing such dark stories. And it gives me a sense of catharsis and of optimism, because I am God in my world. And, you know, things are going wrong in our reality that I sometimes don't have any control over. And, you know, Skyhunter was my 2016 story. So I was angry through a lot of that, the writing of that. But because I was God, am God in this world, I can be like, I have the power to make sure that such and such terrible thing happens to this terrible person, and these good things happen to these good people eventually, you know, after tormenting my readers for long enough. So for me, it's a combination of being able to exaggerate the problems of reality through the, you know, the twisted lens, the mirrors of science fiction, but also knowing that, hey, these are the ways that we can combat this. These are the ways that we can win. And these are the ways that I think we can ultimately feel good about humanity, and that there's hope for the future, that we can do this. And especially writing for white, you know, younger audiences, that you guys will eventually have the power to do this, that you have the power now. And I'm constantly inspired by our real young people who are doing these things and changing our realities, and putting that in my stories to then exaggerate what I'm seeing every day.
See, I like, because the first exposure that I actually had to like real sci-fi in terms of sort of talking about queer issues was Star Trek. And, you know, I remember especially like there was an episode where Beverly Crusher falls in love with a Trill male who then the symbiote is transferred into a female, and they kind of deal with that. And Riker falls in love with a gender neutral character, you know, so, but it was all subtext. And like back then, I mean, I was like 93, so I was like 12 and 13. I didn't even really understand the subtext. And I actually just wanted to do a book that was space, you know, and doing science fiction that I love without subtext. Like there's no subtext, like it's gays and they're in space and they have issues. And, you know, of course it's dark, you know, because I'm dealing with a lot of those issues, but that was it. Like I wanted to kind of go from like subtext to like, it's just there, like they're there. Every single living character in the book is queer. Every single one. There is not a single non-queer living character in the book.
That's fantastic. And I think the more we get that sort of book, and like you're all saying, the dealing with the problems of today, kind of through the future lens, is just making those things more less subtext. That's the norm. It should be the norm. Maybe that's going to be the norm in the future. You know, this shouldn't have to be a continued struggle to find queer characters or diverse characters, or, you know, and it's silly to think that the future, and if we ever meet aliens, that they would be the same as us. So it's great that you guys are exploring those kind of things through the futuristic and sci-fi kind of lens. Kind of leads me into my next question, which thank you guys very much for leading so nicely. All of your books feature love stories or strong friendships or hints at swoon to come. Why include these elements in such action-packed, complex novels? That is to say, where does romance and friendship fit in science fiction?
I mean, science fiction is life, right? And like those friendships and romances, like, I don't know about y'all, but like every single time, like I've fallen in love, it's the absolute worst possible freaking time in life. And like, so I, you know, I think the same thing goes with science fiction. And one of the things that I enjoyed doing with science fiction in this was like each chapter took on a different sci-fi trope. And so I kind of love this idea of then like throwing romance into that, just like they do in TV shows where it's like, you know, the engine is going to blow up and everybody's being poisoned by radiation, but hey, let's talk about our feelings. And I just kind of like love that. So.
I mean, yeah. If the engine's about to blow up and you haven't discussed your feelings before now, it's probably time to do so, right?
Right. You may not get another opportunity.
Exactly.
Don't leave it on.
And then the engine comes back online and it's all good. And then we have just exchanged this awkward kiss and we have to talk about it.
Yeah. But I mean, yeah, I think, I don't know. I'm not sure how I would write a story that didn't have, like, they don't all have to have romance, but that didn't have either romance or friendship in it. I mean, stories are ultimately about who we are as human beings. You know, I think that's what they all are about. And part of who we are is how we relate to ourselves and how we relate to other people. So I think, no, you know, you don't even have to set out to do it. I think it's always going to show up. It's also, I just really enjoy stories with romance in them. I like reading them and I like writing them.
Yeah, I mean, particularly if you're writing younger characters, well, teenage characters, like you probably don't ever feel as intensely in a romantic sense as you do when you're young. So to have teenage characters who weren't feeling that way about other people would kind of strike me as disingenuous, I guess. Also friendship, at least for the Aurora story, it's really the core of the story. It's about kind of a family, a group of people who don't have a hell of a lot in common, but are thrown into this extraordinary circumstance and find out that they have more in common than they first thought. And they, you know, that bond that they form goes on to shape the galaxy around them. So it's a little bit of the power of friendship kind of story. But again, you know, those friendships that you have when you're a teenager, you remember those people for the rest of your life.
Yeah,
yeah, like, you're dealing with really intense emotions.
Yeah, and I that was one of my favorite things about reading Amy and Jay's series, both of their series, because I think you guys do that so, so well. And it's what makes our story still relatable to, you know, to everyone. I mean, none of the other stuff matters if it's not for the friendships and the romance and the, you know, like we all understand that feeling of your heartbreaking and finding your tribe and all of that and getting your crew with you behind your back. And, you know, the galaxy could be exploding, but it doesn't matter if you don't have, you know, your friends and the ones you love. And like, who are you fighting for? Like, why do these things, or why fight the monsters? And yeah. All of that centers around, you know, your relationships with other characters. And like Amie said, it's just fun. Like, it's just really fun to put in those scenes where you're just like, your two characters just going at it in the middle of, like Shaun said, an explosion, or your the tank. It's like, why didn't you ever tell me that you liked holding my hand? It's like, you never asked. And, you know, it's just
right. Right. It's amazing. I think it's important to talk about the fact that we just love it, because people get a bit down on romance sometimes. And I think, you know, like, we've all got our intellectual reasons for why it's important, but also just legit one reason is we love reading it. We love writing it. It's really fun. It's enjoyable. There's nothing like that moment when you have been waiting and waiting and waiting and finally you get that kiss, you know, or, you know, finally you get that moment. And oh, yeah, like, it's an awesome payoff.
How do you guys, Amie and Jay, how do you guys split up the romance duties? Or is it pretty equal across the board when you're writing as a duo?
It's kind of, for us, it's based, we write on character POVs. So we each have kind of three characters that we are ostensibly in charge of. And so whoever happens to be making out at the time is who writes it. In Aurora, I have written a disproportionate amount of kissing scenes. Like, I don't know how that worked out. Particularly this last book, like all of the romance parts were mine. But fortunately, some of Amie's chops in that respect have kind of rubbed off on me. So it started out, I think, more with Amie. But
that's what I was going to say. Is like, when we started writing together, we would hand over things that we knew the other one would do better. So like, when
it's like, this is the kissing part. You write that. I'll go write people dying.
Right, but like if this moment had to pay off, and you know, you had to make such a big deal out of this kiss, Jay would be like, batter up, there you go. Yeah. And you know, and if there was something that was to go, that had to terrify you, I would be like, all right, I've worked out what needs to go in it, but I'm afraid of it, so here you go. And these days, you know, he's like, no, leave me alone, steamy, I got it.
I can like, kiss, it's all good.
I know. And I'm like, all right, leave the lights on with this, my friend. Like, we've over the course of six books just slowly cross-pollinated each other.
Yeah, I mean, that's one of the cool things about writing with a co-author. You not only augment each other's, I guess, weaknesses, like you step into the breach when someone else can't necessarily do as good a job as you, but you also learn from each other constantly. So yeah, that's one of the really cool, fun parts about writing together.
Shaun and Marie, have you guys written with co-authors, or would you want to write with co-authors at some point in the future?
Have you, Marie?
I haven't. I think it sounds so fun and so cool. I'll be honest, I think I'm a little afraid of losing a friend, because I'm just going to drive them insane with the way that I write. I'm a really chaotic writer, so I tend to like go in spurts and just throw in characters in the middle of a story for no reason. And I feel like if I had like a co-author, I would just pass this off and I would just get back emails like, WTF, what is happening? I don't understand. Why is this character exist? Why is this one dead? And I feel like I'm very bad at communicating those things, especially early on. So I don't know. I want my friends to still like me. But yeah. You know, never say never. I would probably do it.
Yeah, I'm with you. Like, I've tried, like, I've taken like those first tentative steps a couple of times, but like as soon as it was like, they're like, okay, let's outline and let's do this, and I'm just like, or we could just like just start in and just start going, and they're just like,
make it up to
go. No, they're like, no, we can't. And I'm like, sure we can. And they're like, no. And I'm like, oh, okay, yeah, no, that's not gonna work. And you know, or it's like, you know, they start working on the outline and then my brain is already like completely like changed the whole story. I'm like, oh, it's not about that anymore. Like, no, we're not, that's not the story we're writing. So yeah, no, I'm with you. Like, my process is like really badly organized chaos. And I wouldn't inflict it on anyone.
We could inflict it on each other, Shaun.
What kind of book would that, like, could you imagine, like, by the end of the book, like, people would be like, they're like, genius or it's madness.
Apparently, David Levithan. So apparently, David Levithan, when he does his co-authored projects, they don't know what is going to happen next. Like, they will send the document off to their co-author, and whatever happens, happens. And then you get the document back and you write up. So if you're planning on doing something really cool with this character and they come back to you dead, then sorry, you have to figure out something. It sounds bananas, but apparently that's the way he does it.
And I mean, you can argue with results.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean,
that sounds like something we may have all done in our creative writing classes. You know, you have to work with someone and they completely change the direction by the time it gets back to you. Oh yeah. One of my favorite things about science fiction, and I am a huge science fiction nerd. I grew up watching Star Trek and Star Wars and all the fun stuff, and I just continue to love it to this day, has been the idea of space travel, but not like gravity space travel, more Star Trek, living in a ship that you aren't going to get, well, most of the time you aren't going to get sucked out. You feel like you're in a hotel in space. So would you guys like to travel in space, and kind of what end of the spectrum would you more be interested in doing? Modern space, you know, the kind of scary spacewalks in suits, or like I said, hotel in space.
Hotel in space.
Yeah, I get badly motion sick, so I'm definitely going to need some form of hotel in space kind of.
Yeah, modern space travel is not comfortable in any way. It's actually awful. Like, you know, you see those magnificent shots of the astronaut kind of floating above the surface of the Earth. Like, that guy is wearing a diaper under that spacesuit. Because when you're outside the craft and it takes, you know, an hour and a half to suit up, you can't come in for a bathroom break. You just got to go in space. So it's a lot grosser than we might imagine it to be. There's a Canadian guy called Chris Hadfield who lived up on the ISS for about 8-9 months, I think. And he did a series of videos on YouTube, and they're still out there. They're amazing. You should go check them out, about what day-to-day life is like on ISS. And it's crazy. Like, problem, you have difficulties in the most mundane of tasks just because there's no gravity. So something like brushing your teeth actually becomes a really difficult proposition because the water doesn't fall down when you turn on the tap. And where do you spit it after you have to swallow your toothpaste in the water because there's nowhere to spit it? Like, it's not at all glamorous. So yeah, hotel in space all the way. USS Enterprise for me, please.
See, I can't even handle camping on Earth, so camping in space would be worse.
It's not like you can go home. It's like, all right, I had enough of this. I want off. It's like, well, you wait till the next ship comes up and gets you off. Yeah. Oh,
man. See, knowing me though, I would choose hotel in space and end up with Avenue 5, where it's like, you know, have you seen that one? It's on HBO, and they get lost in space, and then like their waste system explodes, so there's a giant shell of poop that starts to rotate around the ship. Yeah. It's the most ridiculous show, but that's what I would end up with.
I mean, it is a comedy. It's meant to be.
Oh yeah, it's hilarious, but
On that note, you've all written books in genres other than science fiction as well, be they fantasy, contemporary, dystopia. I mean, dystopia is essentially a science fiction, but how does the world building differ in science fiction versus a different genre like fantasy, where there's magic, or contemporary, where there's just real life?
I guess it depends on the kind of science fiction that you're writing. You know, there's a pretty broad spectrum. You know, on the one hand, you have The Expanse, which is kind of prides itself on taking physics and, you know, real world science into account. And on the other hand, you have something like Star Wars or Star Trek, which is essentially just magic in space. Like, there's no explanation for how that technology can do what it does. It just does it and you run with it because that's one of the principles of the show. So it really depends on the kind of universe you want to build. I mean, I try and take stuff like science and physics into account. We have an astrophysicist that we kind of bounce questions off, just to make sure, because it doesn't matter if you're 500 years in the future or a million light years from here, the laws of gravity are still going to apply. The laws of physics are still going to apply. So we try and have a basic, you know, rules of science that we obey no matter what. But, you know, Illuminae, for example, is a little more real world tech than Aurora. Aurora is closer to the Star Trek, Star Wars type sci-fi. So it really depends on the kind of world you want to build. And, you know, audiences are informed enough about science fiction that, you know, no, everyone knows that a lightsaber doesn't really work in real life. Everyone knows that laser guns are kind of silly, but you run with it because it's fun. There's not a huge amount of pressure to make sure that your science feels real. The most important thing, I guess, is to make your rules consistent so you're not breaking your own laws as you go through. But those laws can be whatever you want.
Right. Yeah. And that's whether you're doing fantasy or sci-fi or whatever. Like if you've got a magic system, it needs to have consistent rules. You know, if you're writing something that's contempt, you know, people, you know, you can't have people get away with stuff that, you know, I decided I'd be on the Oprah Winfrey show, so I was, you know, the rules of society apply. Like, you know, we've still got, you know, no matter where you are, there's rules, but it's kind of what kind of rules are they and what kind of research do you have to do? Like one of our proudest moments was a bunch of people at NASA read Illuminae for a book club and didn't find a mistake. And that was like,
congratulations. You know,
infinite high fives all around.
And that wasn't us. That was our astrophysicist. Like, right. Yeah, we sent her the initial draft and she came back with this 25 pages of all cap notes. It's like, gravity doesn't work like this. Fire and space doesn't work like this. We have to change everything. So
yeah,
it was all her.
Why have we done this? It's a terrible decision. So yeah, we fixed it all. But yeah, I think the rules are rules are rules. But you know, in something like Illuminae, people really expect your physics to be up to scratch. Whereas in other types of sci-fi, you know, so long as it's internally consistent, it doesn't necessarily have to be all science that we can explain right now.
Yeah, one thing, with Skyhunter, it's like Amie and Jay said, it's a little bit more on the spectrum of like the Star Wars type of rules, and I had a little bit more freedom to be loose with it. When I was writing Warcross, which is set in very near future, so it's very near future sci-fi, it's happening like 10 years from now, and it's centered around like augmented reality and virtual reality, how that changes our world. I did feel the difference of that research just because I felt like I was in a race with research because nothing that I put in had to match up with what was happening in real life and still feel like science fiction and not like, oh, they invented this great new thing and it's called the handheld computer. Oh my God. And people are like, yeah, we have that. So I felt like it had to be I was constantly looking up like, you know, the latest Wired issue and the latest, you know, YouTube video from like Apple or whatever, to make sure that what I was putting into the story was felt like it could be happening 10 years from now, but not behind the times. It was a very strange and kind of stressful, you know, feeling to research that and make sure that stuff that I was putting in wasn't dated.
It's a lot harder to do near future stuff. Yeah, for that exact reason, because we're moving so quickly and things are changing so rapidly. Yeah, it's really tricky to do.
Yeah.
But see, I thought like the hardest part for science fiction for me was like deciding what the rules were. You know, because it's like, I mean, most of my stuff is like contemporary, and then I allow myself like one weird thing to happen and then stick with that. Whereas this, it was like, because I don't know if you remember, Marie, like when we were at, it was a festival, like I designed the ship in virtual reality so that I could go and stand on the hull and see like how the shadows would fall. Like I created the light and all that because I couldn't imagine like, how does this work? But like, so like creating the rules, you know, like how things were gonna happen, like that was the most stressful part. Cause it was like, okay, am I going to have like a doctor on board, or is it going to be like a ship computer medic? Like, how are they going to, you know, travel faster than light? Like, mm-hmm. are they going to travel faster than light? Mm-hmm. All of those questions like had to be answered, where it's like contemporary. It's like, I know what the rules are already. And mm-hmm. here it's like the rules can be anything. So what are they going to be? And that was really stressful.
Stressful being God. There's a lot of decisions to make.
Yeah. But it does let you shape the story a lot. Like when you're writing contempt, you know, like leaving aside the kind of the one weird thing idea, kind of you get what you get because it is the way that it is. Whereas, you know, you can, for instance, decide, oh, there is a human medical doctor, but they got killed. or and there's nowhere else to go, or there is a medical program, but here are its limitations that I chose. So you can kind of, with all those choices, you can manipulate the world a lot more to create the kind of story that you want. Whereas I think it would be really hard to do contemp, where it's like, oh, you mean they really do have to go to school each day, or there will be some form of consequence. Well, that's very inconvenient. Okay.
I can't just throw a dragon in because things are getting boring. Like,
I mean, really you hard. Can, but that's a sure, totally different book.
This is how we all end up in sci-fi.
I mean, but that's literally how, like, my book We Are the Ants came about, is I was writing this book about depression and suicide, and then I was like, and I had on my whiteboard, and I wrote aliens, question mark, and aliens. Aliens happen, so...
How much of that rule building goes into the story? I mean, is there kind of a happy medium where you're not, every page you're not saying, and this is the rule for the doctor, and this is the rule for, you know, the light? How do you kind of balance, like, figuring out those rule systems, but then not, like, over inundating the book with, like, too much kind of, you know, early Genesis, he begot so-and-so kind of situation.
Yeah, because, like, what you want to avoid is what we call the as-you-know Bob explanation, where two nuclear scientists stand together at a counter, and one of them says, these counters aren't looking good, and as you know, Bob, if this thing blows, it's going to take out all of Chicago within a three-mile radius. And, like, we sincerely hope Bob knows, because Bob works at the nuclear plant.
It's and, job.
You know, he's very senior. And if Bob doesn't know, then the odds of all of this happening just skyrocketed. So, you know, like, they're not telling each other because they need to know. They're telling each other because we need to know. And it's a really clunky way to do it. Like, what you want is to weave your world building in so that people don't notice. And I think for me, that's in what the characters notice and what the characters take for granted. So, you know, for example, like, you know, in the Aurora series, you know, Aurora herself has just been in stasis for 200 years and awoken to this brand new world. And what she immediately notices, like, holy, that guy is an alien, you know, is completely different to what the people around her are noticing, because to them, an alien is a part of everyday life. And so you can demonstrate an enormous amount of world building without having to sort of explain what's happened, just by having people notice things and think that they're strange or think that they're totally normal. You know, you learn a lot about the world that way.
Yeah, we also cheat a little bit. We had a character, it kind of became a character. It was like a homage to the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, Aurora, because she's this fish out of water character. She got given basically a palm pad that has all the pertinent information that she needs. And so between chapters, when something weird happens to her, she will look it up on her palm pad, and we would have a page at the start of every chapter that explained, you know, this alien race or this space system or this station or whatever. So we kind of, we broke up and compartmentalized our info dumps that way. But in the end, that palm pad actually became a character in the book. And it has really interesting and pertinent information in book three. So we tried, even when we were cheating that info dump, we still tried to incorporate it into the story as much as we could.
Yeah, I created an aging ex-child actress hologram that's on the ship and is explaining things. Like, I actually, because that was, I was worried about that because it was info dump, because all of the characters wake up on a spaceship and they thought they were on Earth before that. And so what I actually ended up doing was weaving what they needed to know and their lack of knowledge and you know, how they got knowledge into the structure of the story itself. So those info dumps became aspects of the story that, you know, readers kind of go, until they get three quarters in and then they go, So like it worked out. So like I used my like you should never do this. I used the, you know, well, you know, Bob specifically, and kind of went, and I'm doing this thing over here. And you know,
yeah,
look,
I mean,
at
that's
that.
Totally different though. Like, If you're hanging a lantern on it and making it really obvious, that's totally different to the bad writing version of it.
Right. Well, but I did it to hide some bad writing because it was so, like, I started out that way because I'm like, I didn't know what I was doing. And then I kind of worked my plot around my inexperience and built that way. So
yeah,
that's why it went through a lot of drafts.
Well, I mean, this is the thing about like writing is, right? Like we can break the rules if we know how to break them. And if you do it in such a way that it is entertaining to the reader, then it's okay. You know, I think at the end of the day, we're just like, I think the cardinal rule of writing is just don't be boring. Like whatever you do, don't be boring. Anything else can go if you can break the rules correctly. It's like what everyone said, like finding these creative ways of putting in the information through like the right character point of view, through, you know, a character that's, you know, meant to do that kind of thing, makes a big difference.
Well, and like one of the things you do in Sky Hunter, Marie, is have characters who think that they know how things are and who think that they understand the system and think that they understand the world, and then find out that things aren't everything that they imagined them to be. She said obliquely, going around spoilers. But, you know, but that, like, you discovering along with the character is another way to build the world in, is, you know, especially when the character thinks they already know. It makes it a really interesting journey with them.
Yeah, this is also my like thought process as I'm figuring it out. Hence chaos.
Yeah. I look forward to reading the next book from Marie and Shaun called Don't Be Boring, right? And that's going to be the co-writing. All right. Well, let's go ahead and jump into some audience submitted questions. Folks had the opportunity to submit questions beforehand. So I'm going to read off kind of who they are and the questions themselves. We already kind of touched on this a little bit. Catherine and Amit, both from Jasper High School, posed similar questions. How do you do effective research for your books? And how do you blend, and we kind of already talked about this, but specifically when writing dystopian or science fiction, do you pull issues from the real world? And how do you kind of exaggerate them to make them fit with the science fiction kind of genre?
Ooh, that's like three questions in one. Yeah.
It is, and I'm sorry that I smashed them all together like that.
I mean, in terms of the research, I think the thing is, we're not astrophysicists. Like, we are many excellent things, but like, yeah, accomplished scientists, not so much. Which means we can't go look up university papers and stuff to research. You know, we start with, like, Jay and I start with things like the Chris Hadfield videos that Jay was mentioning. You know, we start with stuff that's basic and, you know, start, like, educate ourselves that way, and then, you know, figure, like, follow little threads and ask people who know stuff. You know, I think people are often really happy to answer questions, provided you come to them having done a little bit of prep and respecting their time. You know, we all like to talk about what's interesting to us, so we start with basics and then we sort of track down our threads and look for people who can explain things to us and then probably explain things to us again when we didn't understand it the first time.
Hank Green did an amazing series as well. Hank Green and his team, it was like an offshoot of SciShow called SciShow Space. It went for years and there's hundreds of episodes up there. They're probably 5 minutes a piece and they'll just talk about something kind of interesting. Mm-hmm. And if you're a kind of sci-fi type nerd, they're actually really fun to watch, but you also learn a whole bunch that you can incorporate into your stories. Because space is weird. Like, there's some incredibly cool stuff that happens out there, and you can hang entire stories off a simple factoid. So I would definitely recommend watching that series to start, for sure.
And when you guys do reach out, Amie and Jay, you were talking about how you work with an astrophysicist. And Shaun and Marie, I'd be curious to know if you guys have ever reached out to experts. How do you go about doing that when you're looking for help doing research? And do you have any advice if aspiring writers are looking for someone to help in that aspect with their research?
I just yelled on Twitter. Yeah, politely. that's a really good place to start.
Yeah, like
I put out a call on Twitter, and I'm lucky in the sense that I have a following, so that might be difficult for someone just starting out to do. That can be tricky, I guess.
Yeah. I mean, it's surprising what your network knows, you know, even just asking the people, you know, if anyone knows someone, you know, asking your friends in real life as well as on social media, you know, does anyone know someone, does anyone's family know someone who knows about this thing? But then when you get to them, there's a real difference between showing up and saying, hi, I don't know anything about weaving. Can you just teach me everything about weaving now? Like it's lazy and it's asking them to do all the work for you. And it's telling them that you want them to do the work and you haven't bothered. Whereas if you show up and you say, hi, I've got a character and they're going to be a weaver and I'm looking for something that they could be weaving that would demonstrate their particular expertise and would show that they're a really finicky personality who doesn't mind doing, you know, really intricate things and has the patience for it. You know, could you point me at some kinds of patterns or techniques that would work for that kind of thing? That tells them you've thought about it, that what they're giving you is going to be valuable. You know, it helps them help you, and it also, yeah, shows some respect for their time, I think. So
yeah, and shows you're invested as well.
Yeah.
Reddit is another good place as well. I've asked a couple of questions about botany, weirdly enough, because the world that I'm currently writing has no sunlight, so I wanted to know what that would actually do to flora and fauna, and so I got onto the R botany list and just asked a couple of questions. And Reddit is pretty amazing in some respects, because there are, you know, there's millions of people who use that site, and someone is probably going to know the answer to your question. So yeah, but again, approach respectfully and try and do as much of the work you can yourself, before you start asking other people to get invested in your project with you.
Yeah, I mean, I think that is important, like making sure that you're not wasting their time. Like I had a math question about, you know, air being expelled from a spaceship and how fast it would go and what would the pressure be. And I got the math, like, you know, Googling and reading, like I got the math like almost all the way there. And then I reached out and I found someone who was willing to look it over and then take me the rest of the way, you know. But they were like, oh, okay, you really screwed this up here, but nice try, you know? And,
yeah.
And they were like appreciative, you know, that I tried and didn't just come and say, I need you to do math for me, you know, which is normally what I would do because I suck at math. So,
I mean, Jay and I once asked our astrophysicist to check a travel time, and we sat there together for a really long time and tried really, really
hard. Like, we really tried.
We really tried hard. And I think in the end,
we got it so wrong.
It was going to be like 4¾ days, we thought, but we just weren't 100% sure. And she came back and she's like, it's 5 months, you idiots. Okay, well, that changes the plot of Gemini significantly. Okay. Yeah. All
math,
right.
Math is not our thing.
Good to know.
Yeah, the old train.
But we tried.
Well, I think she appreciated that we had a
go. It's probably called the math friends around the computer. As you was Ryan. Look at these
Look
idiots.
At these nerds. Yeah.
That's great. All right. So this, Marie, this question is specifically for you, but anyone else, please feel free to chime in. Amy from Creek Valley Middle School asks, Marie, I've loved your books for the longest time ever. I've fallen in love with your writing ever since I read Legend. Will you be making movies and or TV series for any of your books? It would be so exciting to see these plots in action.
Well, that is super, super sweet, first of all. I love hearing movies, especially, you know, during pandemic time, because I'm just stuck in my house all the time, and it's really, really nice to hear from everyone. I don't have control over the TV film process, but having said that, it would be really awesome if they were all made, so fingers crossed. I have interesting and fun news on the Legend front that I hope I get to share someday, soon. And Warcross is in really good hands right now with Made Up Stories. So fingers crossed, but you know, whenever I have something to share that I can share publicly, I will definitely let people know on my social media. And I wish I could say more than that, but you know, I have, it's one of those areas where, you know, when I first got into writing, I did not know that this was like a potential related thing to be able to dabble in TV and film and that kind of thing. And it all sounds very fun and really cool and kind of terrifying. So yeah, just fingers crossed all the time.
Awesome. Question for everyone or those who would like to answer. Mia from Jasper High School is curious. Do you always start your books knowing how they will end? Or do you figure it out along the way?
I always think I know how it's going to end.
Yeah.
And I think I have never actually known how it was going to end.
Yeah, that's true, actually. I think, like, we usually have a sense of where we're going. Like, you can see the mountain on the horizon that you're driving towards. It's all of the road in between that's obscured. But actually, with Aurora 3, we completely changed the ending as we were working.
It's a slightly different mountain.
Yeah, we're like, we cut one to the left.
That's the mountain next door, yeah.
Yeah.
I personally need to have some indication of what the ending is going to be before I can start writing. Otherwise, I just wander. Like, it's like Amie says, the analogy is there's a city or a mountain on the horizon and you're kind of driving in that direction because otherwise you could end up anywhere. And the road may take interesting twists and turns along the way, but if you keep that city in your eye line, then you will eventually get to where you want to be. But yeah, a lot of the time it is a different city that you thought it was going to be when you arrive in it. But for me, it gives me a sense of direction, literally, in the story. It gives me something to aim towards. Otherwise, you know, you can go anywhere and you can get lost. So that helps for me personally.
I'm just realizing this metaphor also works because whenever Jay and I go on tour, we always ask if we can drive instead of fly. Because one, I don't know if you've ever tried taking a guy who's 6'7" on a plane every day, but just like, it's no fun for anyone. And also Jay gets randomly
covered in tattoos.
Yeah, he gets
randomly searched
everywhere we go. It's a real pain in the butt. So we always ask, you know, if it's like a 4-hour drive or less, can our publisher instead just like rent us a car and we'll drive? And like, we literally are driving for the city on the horizon. And we're usually, just to get kind of meta, plotting a book while we're doing it. Like, we did the entire finale of Obsidio driving towards Austin while...
Through Texas, yeah.
Yeah, and I sat there with, like, this giant bit of paper kind of plotting out where everyone would go and what they would do as we talked through it. So I just realized that we literally drive towards the landmark on the horizon while we plot our way towards the metaphorical landmark on the horizon.
Do you sometimes end up at physically the city next door?
The very first time we did it, our publicist was absolutely convinced we were going to get totally and utterly lost and was like, text me the whole time you're driving. So I Googled something that was an hour in the wrong direction and found a picture of the sign. And I texted it to her and we're like, it's going really well. And then she just stopped asking after that.
Well, Amie and I have this story because we went on a trip to Japan once together and we're both have a terrible sense of direction.
Yeah.
And we did not want to admit this to each other. And we got off the train. We're like, we know where we're going. And then we saw this girl with amazing hair. And we're just like, we just started following her. We didn't even realize it. And then we follow her, like 5 blocks? And then we're like,
mesmerized. What are we doing? Yeah, and then we looked up and we were like, not only do we not know where we've gone, we now don't know where our apartment is either. We've followed this. Yeah, it was great hair though.
It was so worth it.
Yeah. We brought back a lot of important Warcross research that trip.
Well, I was gonna say, driving through certain parts of Texas, no offense to Texas, but certain parts of Texas are very much like outer space. There's nothing. And it's very flat and very just, you can see forever.
But it's a lot like Australia, so we kind of felt right at home.
Yeah.
Very nice. Let's see, another question. A bunch of people had very similar questions, and I'll try not to combine 3 questions in one like I did the first time. But Billy from Lady Bird Johnson High School, Shritha from Jasper High School, Sukarat from Travis Middle School, and Chase from Pearson Middle School all had very similar questions. Is there anything from your childhood that inspired your writing or something from your life that influenced the way that you write?
I don't think we have enough time for that. Like, this is a whole therapy session.
Yeah.
Well, let's see. We have, you know, 6 more minutes. Let's see what we can do.
I always just say everything. Like, everything ends up somewhere.
Yeah. Yeah. And, like, events do, but more than that, your experiences and your feelings and, like, you take that time that you felt totally embarrassed and you put it in. You take that time that you stood at the door to a room, you know, a party or something, and you like didn't want to go in because you were so anxious about it, and you put that in, and like it might be a totally different moment in the book, but you take all the stuff that's happened to you and you put it in. And you also, any author who tells you, you know, oh no, I never base anyone on people that I know is lying to you. We also definitely steal things from people that we see and that we meet and that we know. Just not the whole
only bits, yeah. You don't want to put a whole person you know in your book, particularly in a book where people tend to have horrible things happen to them, because that's a good way to lose your friends.
Yeah.
Okay. Unless they're exes. Like, exes are okay. Exes are fair game.
Yeah, I shouldn't be reading your book anyway, right? Although Jay and I get asked a lot, because we killed off just, you know, almost every author we knew in the Illuminae series. And people, like at the beginning, people were like, do you guys have like a feud with most of YA? And we were like,
you got beef with Bardugo.
All of them.
Yes, all of them versus Australia. No, this is how we show love. We thought it was cool. Is it not cool? Yep. Uh-oh.
Well, that goes back to our kind of my opening question of all the people yelling at you, how dare you, how could you do this? They keep coming back for more. So obviously, you know, I'm sure a vast majority of readers would probably enjoy being killed off in one of y'all's books or said something horrible to happen to a character named after them.
Seems I mean, like- we held a competition for the third Illuminae book for people to get their names in the book. And everyone who won the competition actually wound up in a pit full of dead bodies. That was where everyone's name got used. But no one complained. It's all good.
I mean, we warned them. We did say
we did. Something bad will probably happen to you. It is our book, so yeah.
All right. We have time for one more question, I think. And just wanted to know kind of what's been your favorite book recently that you've read?
I'm actually reading one that came out a little while ago, but it's just made to the top of my stack now. It's called Sea Fire by Natalie C. Parker. And it is basically like Mad Max Fury Road on ships. It's incredible. It's got like all of the anger and action and feminism and badassery of Mad Max Fury Road. And it's, yeah, on the water. Loving it.
I've got it right in front of me. It's actually, my computer is resting on it because I was reading it.
I'm doing the exact same thing.
Edge it out.
It's the fourth book in Sam Shannon's series. I love Sam. She's amazing. She's one of the best fantasy writers in the world at the moment. I'm about 3/4 of the way through that one and loving it. So yeah, if you haven't got in on the Bone Season yet, get in on it. It's great.
I'm actually halfway through Last Night at the Telegraph Club by Melinda Lowe. And it's gorgeous. And it's interesting because I'm pretty sure that one was based on her short story in All Out and an anthology of queer historical stories. And my short story, I wrote a whole book and that one's out in September. And so it's really neat to be reading hers, but I mean, it's gorgeous. It's gotten like a billion stars and it's worth every single one of them. It's so beautiful.
Yes, I also highly recommend all of the authors that were previously mentioned because they are all phenomenal and their books are phenomenal. I, like Jay, was also using like a massive fantasy book to pop up my laptop. They're not really great stories, but they make great, you know, Zoom shelves. So I'm in the middle of reading Realmbreaker by Victoria Yard and thoroughly loving it. It is just everything that is great about fantasy. And I can't say much about it because it's not out yet, but look out for it when it comes out.
Awesome, fantastic. Well, that's unfortunately all the time we have for today, but I wanna thank you guys again so much for being here with me today and being a part of the festival. And thank you to everybody who's watching the panel. If you missed out on watching any panels earlier today or yesterday, be sure to check out the NTTBF website at NorthTexasTeenBookFestival.com. And just wanted to thank you guys. If anybody watching would like to purchase the books we talked about today or any other books by other festival authors, please do so at bookshop.org/shop/NTTBF, which will benefit the festival. You can also find if you want any NTTBF swag at the festival's website. Thank you guys so much. This was amazing. So great talking with you, and have a great rest of your day. And thank you again. Thanks so much, everyone.
Thank you for moderating.
Thanks, Mandy.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye. Bye.